This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
One day, when the glory comes, it will be ours. It will be ours. Oh, one day, when the war is won, we will be sure.
To the heavens, no man, no weapon formed against, yes, glory is destined. Everyday women and men become legends. Sins that go against our skin become blessings. The movement is a rhythm to us. Freedom is like religion to us. Justice is juxtapositioning us. Justice for all just ain't specific enough. One son died, his spirit is revisiting us. True and living, living in us. Resistance is us. That's why Rosa sat on the bus. That's why we walked through Ferguson with our hands up. When it go down, we woman and man up. They say stay down, and we stand up. Shots, we on the ground. The camera panned up. King pointed to the mountaintop, and we ran up.
One day.
Good morning. Welcome to Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. You know my voice already. It's Leyvon Miller. Thank you so much for joining me. Thank you so much for letting me join you. I don't have a clue what it is that you do at 11 o'clock, but whatever it is that you do, I'm happy that you're doing that do and that you decided to do that do with me. You know, it is Tuesday, and because I am a man like George Washington, I cannot tell lies. I promise that every Tuesday in the month of October, since I care about breasts and breasts care about me, and since I love breasts because breasts first love me, because I believe that everything that have breasts ought to praise the Lord, I've decided that I'm going to come in here on Tuesdays and we're going to talk about you and your breasts, you and your health with your breasts. And then we're just going to have me in there, who is going to be the greatest supporter of all time. So what I've decided to do is we are going to talk about the stories, the journey through cancer, the journey through remission. Of course, there are many of you out there that have found yourselves either the victims of or the supporters to women that have suffered through breast cancer challenges. And I want to use the word suffer gingerly, right? Because there are some women out there that have actually given breast cancer the fight of its life. They didn't all just curl up into a big old ball and die, like Lenny says, right? Some of them actually put their backs to the wall, turned and faced cancer, and fought it with everything they had. And so I'm happy to be able to talk about those women, right? I'm happy to be able to put them on display. And so this is, again, another show in my Tata Tuesday series because, you know, we live in a conservative society, and so I'm not always allowed to say all of the words that I'd like to say, and so we will call them Tata Tuesdays. And for the people that don't like that, all I can say to you is, tough titty, said the kitty. All right? So I'm joined in the studio this morning by Janine LaRota, who is a 11-year breast cancer survivor. She has actually been on with me before in another incarnation of my life. And we are talking all things breast this morning. So let me give you the numbers early. You can call me 323-623-2325-4316-325-4259. Y'all say I say them too fast every day. I'll say them again for you. 323-623-2325-4316-325-4259. You can call me on any one of those numbers. You can text me, though, which is what I recommend. 422-4796. Janine LaRota, good morning. How are you?
Good morning, Leyvon. I'm fine.
You look dazzling since the last time I've seen you. You seem to have a steady progression with life after breast cancer. What exactly is keeping you so pumped and just motivated to go on after the battle with breast cancer?
Hey, Leyvon, just knowing that I am living on the promise of God, because mm-hmm. when I was first diagnosed, mm-hmm. He promised that he was going to be here with me. And right. every day I look in the mirror, I say, hey, I'm still here doing exciting things. And, you know, I give God thanks mm-hmm. for allowing me to mm-hmm. be on his promise. Mm-hmm. And so that motivates me every day, mm-hmm. knowing that every day is a good day because I'm here.
So, okay. So 11 years ago, I imagine science wasn't what it is. People weren't as sensitive as they are. Many things weren't what they are today. You go to a doctor. What exactly was the process to discovering breast cancer, and at what stage?
Okay, for me, I'm a person, because I'm short, I'm so conscious of my weight.
Right.
And I was exercising one evening, and every time I throw my arm, I'm a fan of Tai Bo.
Okay.
You know, it makes me feel like I'm doing karate.
Okay.
You know?
Okay.
And so,
okay, Kung Fu Panda.
Watch out for me. Watch out for me, man.
Okay.
You know, I was just throwing my arm, and every time I threw my arm, I would get a very sharp pain, and I'm like, hey, what's this? And I couldn't do the exercise. 10 minutes into the exercise, I just gave up. And I went and I took a shower, because everybody know who... into Tai Bo, it's a lot. You do a lot of sweating, mm-hmm. even a few minutes into it. Mm-hmm. So I went right into the shower. And while I was in the shower, I remember them saying, you know, how to put your hand in the back of your head and mm-hmm. feel under your arm. And at that point, I felt a lump. And I felt one, and then I keep feeling. And not only did I feel one, I felt two. And immediately I said, oh, that's not good. Mm-hmm. And so immediately I say, you know what, I got to do something about it. I didn't just, okay, say, I'm just having a pain, and it's just a lump. Mm-hmm. I said, I got to call my doctor. At the time, I didn't really have a private doctor. It's just my gynecologist. Mm-hmm. So
you didn't have a primary physician?
Not at that time.
Okay.
Just the gynecologist. Mm-hmm. And so I said, I got to make an appointment. And so that was my first thing. I called my doctor's office, gynecologist's office, and they gave me an appointment, and it was like 2 weeks away, mm-hmm. 3 weeks away.
Wow.
They were the longest 3 weeks of my life. Because mm-hmm. here it is, I feel a lump, and I don't know what it is, and I have to wait to see my doctor, because you know the office is so really busy.
Right.
And so that was the first instance I did. I went and I make an appointment, and I had to wait a while. And when I went to my gynecologist, he said, you know, Janine, this is very suspicious. Mm-hmm. I would suggest that you go and see. He gave me a name of a surgeon, mm-hmm. you know, that you would have to. No, he said that you would have to go and have a mammogram done.
Okay.
I have never had one done before.
Right. How old were you?
I was 38 at the time.
Wow.
Yes, 38, going on to 39. No, okay. Actually, I just had my... Yes, I was 38 years old, Leyvon. Yeah. And didn't have a, because there was nobody in my family that I knew who would have had breast cancer.
So you're a fairly young woman doing Tai Bo. You feel like you're in the best shape of your life. You could stop a train. You're practicing Kung Fu. And here it is now. The doctor tells you something is happening with your breast that makes him concerned.
Mm-hmm.
38 years old. You know, I just said yesterday in social media, I don't know, the women around the Bahamas seem to be summoning the power of Grayskull, because they are all now going into parenthood at 40.
Right.
Right? When 20 years ago, the science would have suggested that it was almost impossible to get a woman pregnant after 40. Right? Now, you see women going into their sojourn as mothers at 40. Breasts are a large part of parenting, right?
Right.
And so at 38, you mm-hmm. find out, something's happening with your breasts.
Mm-hmm.
Where does your mind take you then?
Well, believe it or not, I had a baby at that time.
You see, this is the thing I talk about now.
Mm-hmm. And my son before her, mm-hmm. I breastfed him until he was about 5 months old.
Mm-hmm.
And so in my mind, now I have this new baby. I want to breastfeed until she's about 5 years old, mm-hmm. you know? And she didn't want to take the breath.
Uh-huh.
At that time, you know, I didn't know why she didn't want to have the breast, but then here it is, 2 years later, I find that I'm being diagnosed with breast cancer. And believe it, I wanted to have another child too.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And
after 38.
After 38.
That's the name of the love.
I wanted to make it even. Okay. I have two girls and a son, and I wanted to see if my husband could have shoot it right and give me another boy.
Yeah, you wanted two pairs.
Yes.
Okay. You sound like a poker player too.
Go well, on. We never really planned any pregnancy, because all the kids are 8 years apart, believe it or not. Mm-hmm. I like to tell the story.
And you're just that good.
Yes, I just, they born August, September, and October.
Mm-hmm.
And not only that, the juicy body, born 11, the 12, and the 13th.
See that?
And so I wanted to,
you this one to be like, you should get into playing numbers while you're at it.
No.
Okay, so you have another child. You're 38. You find out that something's happening with your breast. You go to do the mammogram. Mm-hmm. Do you remember the doctor you go to see?
Okay, I went right there to Fort Terrace Imaging Center. Mm-hmm. And when I was there, I saw them looking, you know, and I started to feel uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. Like, I guess doing these imaging every day or so often, they could tell right away if something mm-hmm. is wrong. And they suggested that I go and do an ultrasound. And when I was doing the ultrasound, I saw the technician, these knots in his forehead. And I'm like, okay, oh boy, this is not good. And, but of course, you know, they can't give you what, they can't tell you what they see, because the results have to go to your physician. And so when I had the appointment set to go and see my doctor, oh my God, sitting in his office. Well, at that time I had chosen Dr. Loxley Monroe, because I wanted him to do the surgery. And sitting in his office waiting in those, in his foyer, was the longest hours of my life. Mm-hmm. I sat there for about 3 hours waiting to see him, because Dr. Monroe, he's a doctor that he really takes time with his patients. Mm-hmm. And so me sitting there after him waiting, after he's seeing another patient, I'm like, I got angry. Mm-hmm. And I walked out. I say, three hours, that's a long time to be waiting. Mm-hmm. And not to knock down Dr. Monroe's office, because mm-hmm. he's an excellent doctor and he is thorough. Mm-hmm. He takes his time. If you have 1,000,001 questions, he answers them all.
Okay.
So I just walked out his office and I told the lady that was sitting at the reception, I'm not coming back. I said, doc is going to have to come to me to give me my results. Mm-hmm. I meant it, because that's how angry I was at the time. And he called me the next morning and he said, Janine, you have to come into my office. I said, doc, I'm not coming. I said, you don't know what that's like to be sitting in the office waiting to hear if you have cancer or not, you know? And so I say, you could tell me over the phone. He say, that's not policy. I say, well, I'm authorizing you.
Mm-hmm.
And when he told me that, yes, you have cancer, I said, doc, are you sure that's Janine Glenda or Barry LaRota's file you're looking at?
Right.
And he said, yes, it is. I said, well, you tell you what, doc, I'll be coming into your office to make sure you are looking at Janine Glenda's or Barry LaRota's file.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And so at what stage were you?
In the beginning when I did when they did the biopsy,
mm-hmm.
and they said the lump off, it was stage 1.
Okay.
And by the time I had scheduled a surgery to have that lump removed, and I went off, it was to do the lumpectomy, if I know that I was at a stage 3.
Wow.
So in that short time of me finding out in August, because that's when I got the news, the end of August, mm-hmm. that I was breast cancer, mm-hmm. I had breast cancer. The surgery was scheduled for September 29th.
Mm-hmm.
And at that time, I was already at a stage 3. So that's why it's so important not to wait.
So you go from a lumpectomy, mm-hmm. right? See, this is what I love about breast. Well,
mm-hmm.
Let me know what I love about breast cancer. Mm-hmm. See, breast cancer have variations and stages, and then the language changes and it gets complicated, right?
Uh-huh.
So you went to have a lumpectomy.
I had a biopsy, then I had a lumpectomy because I wanted to preserve my breast.
You wanted to still keep the breast where it was.
Yes, I want to keep
them. No problem. So mm-hmm. the lumpectomy means they would just go in, take out the little lump, stitch it back up, you'd mm-hmm. be good to go, you'd still mm-hmm. have a full breast.
Right,
okay,
right.
So you discover you have stage 3 cancer. What is now the recommendations of the doctor?
Well, he gave me 3 choices. Well, before I did have that, the lumpectomy, he said that I have 3 choices. I can either just do nothing,
mm-hmm.
or I can do the lumpectomy, or I can cut off both.
Mm-hmm.
Another time, like I said, I wanted to preserve them, so that was my choice then at the time.
Mm-hmm.
But that's not only that, Leyvon. I after having that lumpectomy, now I have to go and find out what form of treatment I'm going to do
mm-hmm.
after, you know, having mm-hmm. the lumpectomy, because, you know, there's chemotherapy and there's radiation.
Mm-hmm.
And so even though I had the lumpectomy, my husband still wasn't satisfied. He still wanted to go and get other opinions on mm-hmm. how to go about treatment. And we ended up in the U.S. at Mount Sinai. And when I was over there, they said they found out that the cancer had returned.
Wow.
And this from September. Now, remember now, I started out having stage one breast cancer. Mm-hmm. Then find out I have stage three.
Mm-hmm.
Did a lumpectomy. Now waiting to recover from that. Six mm-hmm. weeks later, go over there. And I find out that, hey, the cancer is back.
Mm.
And so they say, okay, we can't wait any longer. We can't do any surgeries. We have to start treatment right away.
Wow.
Now, I only went over there for an opinion.
For an opinion, right.
And so their advice to me was to start chemotherapy right away. And they gave me the options of how many cycles that I would want to go. And I just chose the shortest cycle, which was six.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because I didn't want to go 9 months, 18 months of through these treatments. Because you hear so many crazy stories.
People, affects people differently. Right?
You know, about chemotherapy.
So I imagine that this entire time you were covered by insurance because, you know, you're talking about traveling to America and getting second opinions, and you did the procedures in America as well?
I did them home. I did all the procedures here at home. Mm-hmm. I just did the treat because I felt like if I'm going to be laying up for 6 weeks or whatever, I want to be where family was and my kids.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I didn't want to be away from them that long. But I did all the treatment where I used to go every 3 weeks, every 21 days. Every time I'm feeling better, here it's time to go start it all over, the process all over again. And I also did the, not only did I did the six cycles of chemotherapy, I did radiation. And I ended up doing going away further because, you know, it's expensive because you have to find living. Yes, I had insurance right. at the time. Thankfully, with my husband, I was on his insurance. And so that helped us a lot. But, you know, of course, they don't pay for accommodation.
Right, right.
And so every time I went, every 3 weeks we go, that's plane ticket for both of us. He was supportive all the way through because he went on every trip with me and sat with me during every session, which lasted for 5 hours at a time, the treatments. And after doing those treatments, I had an in-laws that lived somewhere in Baltimore, and I ended up there for radiation. So I spent 3 months up there because I had to do 6 weeks of radiotherapy.
Yeah. So, okay, you've done the therapy in America because the cancer was back. What happened then? Do you need to make more decisions about procedures and that kind
yes,
of stuff?
Exactly, yes. Because after treatment now, here it is that I have to, doc advise me, you know, that they have to remove the breast.
Mm-hmm.
And so
this is a mastectomy.
Yes,
this is different now, from a lumpectomy.
Yes, now, yes.
I want you all to stay with me on
yes,
this.
Yes, we've gone from a biopsy to a lumpectomy, now to a mastectomy.
Right.
And he advised they wanted to take off the, because I found it in the right breast.
Mm-hmm.
And so, because, you know, in my mind, I said I was willing to have the cut off because I said, no, I don't go through all that, you know?
A lot of women aren't prepared to part with them, though. Like, you know, they, you know, you kind of don't have them when you're born. You get them around 13. You kind of hate them. Well, no, you kind of like them between 16 and 25.
Mm-hmm.
And then from like 25 to 35, they're just kind of knocking around. And then, you know, they go from knocking around to you might need to cut them off. And a lot of women, you know, as much as they complain about them, many women complain, oh, these do nothing but make me tired. These are heavy. I always got to put on a bra.
Mm-hmm.
You go from complaining about them to, wait a minute now, I don't dislike them enough to want them off.
Right.
But you're saying now that you were good with it.
Well, not exactly right away, because my husband, he's those kind of person who goes to the doctor if even a bee stinks up.
Mm-hmm.
So now here it is, I have cancer. So now he's going to be seeking all the medical advice and terms and searching and Googling. Mm-hmm. So he said, if you have to take them off. And I said, oh, really? Well, I wasn't depending upon him, because some women, I think, they go by with their spouse or their other significant other.
That is a major factor. I keep telling people, breasts are to a woman what tassel is to a Christmas tree. All right? We could put this Christmas tree in here.
Uh-huh.
We could even put light on it.
Yes.
Until you put the shiny stuff on the Christmas tree, this is not a Christmas tree.
It's not a Christmas
tree. Yeah, and so the breasts are, you know, they're like ornamental, but functionally ornamental.
Mm-hmm.
We need them
because
you all need us to need them. Right? And so it's not usual, or I find it commendable. Let me not say it's not usual. I find it commendable that your husband takes the position that, you know what, girl, man, you're still going to be beautiful.
He still had another toy.
This is one thing I love about live radio. You can't practice this stuff. Okay, so he's comfortable with it.
Mm-hmm.
that makes you comfortable with it, you make the decision to do the mastectomy.
Yes. Okay. Yes.
Now, there's two types of mastectomies. There's mm-hmm. a, what do they call it? You got to give me the terminologies. I don't know. One mean one, the next one mean two.
Well, listen. Well, Well, at that time, they told me that I had to take the breast. So I told the doctor, mm-hmm. if you're going to take home girl, you better carry sister
carry
girl.
A sister. Carry a sister.
Carry a sister too. Mm-hmm. You know, because these twins, because I'm not going through the process of finding, hey, now I cut off one breast and here a month later, cancer is in the neck, the other breast. Because mm-hmm. now you hear my story. I going from stage one to stage three to finding out, okay, you had the surgery now, and now you go back to start chemotherapy and you find out the cancer is back. You know, it's mm-hmm. like, this looked like this was chasing me down. Mm-hmm. So I say, you know, I'm not fooling with this. So they agreed that, okay, we'll do it. I said, it's not a choice. You don't have a choice. You're going to carry both of them. Mm-hmm. And I did it because guess what? I already had three kids. Mm-hmm. And like you say, the breasts, you know, you enjoy them at one point. And at that point, breasts, my eyes was hanging down, my Levi. Yeah, but I was going. I had to been tired of my strap too high to keep them up where they're supposed to be.
Right, right. So you do the double mastectomy.
Yes, double okay. mastectomy. That's
and it. That is with only one of the breasts being affected.
Yes.
When you wake up, though, right? Like, I don't... My grandmother did a mastectomy. She never talked about it, you know what mm-hmm. I mean? She didn't do hers till she was 62. Mm-hmm. But my other grandmother had to do an amputee of her right leg. And, you know, she said, boy, you know, one of the things that is most interesting to me mm-hmm. is some days I feel like I got peeing in my heel, but I have no heel, right? And so, I mean, you get up off the surgery table...
Mm-hmm.
You're used to having them there for 38 years.
Right? Yes.
No matter what condition they was in, whether mm-hmm. they were victims of gravity or not, right?
Yes.
You wake up and they're no longer there. Mm-hmm. Do you kind of feel around for them in the early days because they ain't standing up, they ain't laying to the side, they're not there.
They're just not there.
Yeah. Does that take some getting used to in your mind?
Yes, it does. When I first, especially after the bandages came off, I was afraid to look at mm-hmm. them, mm-hmm. you know? And I kind of like cover myself because, hey, now I don't want my, even though he was okay with it, I didn't want him to look at me.
Okay.
And I didn't want the kids to see, you know? Mm-hmm. And then I looked down and then there was no breasts. All I could see was belly. So I say, Doc, now my breast gone, my belly look as big.
You couldn't suck some of that out there while y'all was in there.
I said, hey, God, but he say, that was always there, so you just couldn't see him for the breast, you know?
Right.
And so, you know, it's like I got caught after my husband was okay seeing, because he's the one when the doctor took off the bandages, he looked at it first and he said, don't cover up, because I'm like, you know, trying to not let him really see, you know, because still have a little bit of pride left in me, you know. And so after I looked at them and I got used to it, you know, I became so comfortable. I had to remind myself that I was still a woman. I used to like walking around the house bareback. Here it is. I don't have to wear a bra because I hated them.
Right.
Even the girls was a little bit heavy.
Right.
When I reached home, the bras, that was the first thing that I wanted to get rid of, mm-hmm. you know, because they were uncomfortable to me,
right.
you know. And in going through breast cancer, you find out which bra is right from you, from what isn't, you know.
And this is stuff that you don't ordinarily learn.
Yeah, you know, right. You don't pay attention to these things, the underwire, because we figure if we get the underwire, it's going to make our breasts look more perky and, you know, pump up a little bit, you know, and to show them off. But they're not good for you because, you know, I realize that.
They look good,
yeah. But it ain't good for the body.
Ain't nothing like when breasts standing up like a police constable on an Independence Day parade while the Governor General passes. And that's how I like them to look.
That's how they're supposed to be.
Just how the constable look, that's how I want them to look. And standing at attention and no movement at all.
No movement at all. Yeah. It's perfect.
But you're saying that's not good.
But they're not good if you're not wearing the right bra there. And then, you know, the breast isn't just in front of you. Mm-hmm. The breast is under the armpit area. So the breasts start from there.
Mm-hmm.
So when you get those extra, but you got to make sure you squeeze them and fold them. And because, you know, sometimes they look at women and they get some hanging along the side and some to the top. And it's like, automatically, they don't have on the right bra,
mm-hmm.
and that could contribute to, you know, I believe that could contribute to developing breast cancer somewhere, you know?
So you said it's been 11 years now. That's 11 years in remission.
Yes.
Okay. So did you have any challenges post-surgery?
Post-surgery, You know, going through the treatments, there were so many different side effects that I went through.
Okay.
First of all, I lost my hair right away. I remember sitting down one morning doing my devotions, and I just touched my head, and all my hair just fall off into the, you know. So, you know, you have those emotional moments.
Yeah.
You know.
Some women just opt to go straight to cutting it off. Like, that's what my grandmother did. My grandmother just cut it off so it didn't drop off.
It's right. Some women do that. And today, I still struggle with my hair growth because, you know, sometimes the chemotherapy, it messes up with some of the certain things in your body. Such a thing like, I used to have nice full hair.
Right.
But guess what, Leyvon? I change my hairstyle all the time. One day I'm blonde, one day I'm redhead, one day I'm Chinese.
Right.
So
you
could just kick cancer in his butt and you could play with it. So that's what I did. And before, you know, and not having breasts, Leyvon, you know what I used to do? Mm-hmm. If I feel like having no breasts, I went up with no breasts.
Yeah.
You know, people stared at me, but it didn't care. It didn't bother me at all. Because I know, hey, you know, cancer could never get them no more.
No,
you know?
So you could, and then I guess you kind of could play with it. Like one day you could go with A's, one day you could go with B's.
How you mean? I was just about to tell you that.
Yeah.
Depends on what I'm wearing.
Depends on what you're wearing. You can decide, right?
You.
Like, you know, like some people say, I don't have the right breast for this outfit. You don't have to worry about that because you could just pick the breast.
I have the choice, you know? Yeah, I have a choice. I had a choice, and that's what I did. And I made my coworkers laugh one day. I stepped up to work. I said, man, I want a double D today. Here I go to work. I made my chest puffed up, and nobody really noticed.
Yeah.
And I got upset. I'm like, okay, then y'all notice something different about me today?
Yeah.
They say, I start shaking them up, and they said, I'm wearing double D's today, you know?
So it sounds to me like one of the ways to kind of get along this journey of breast cancer is to not just be physically strong, but you kind of need a level of mental stability and sobriety to get you through it as well.
Yes, because
you got to be able to laugh at yourself.
Yes, you have. Because a lot of women, I think they get embarrassed or they're ashamed that they have breast cancer and don't want to tell anybody, and they kind of keep it a secret.
Mm-hmm.
That's nothing you did to yourself. It happens to anyone.
Mm.
And it just not, breast cancer doesn't happen to women, but it happens to male as well.
So you say it's all right to get your breast feel up if you're a man, just to make sure you ain't
have
a lumpectomy.
Yes.
All right, so I could go see what I could do.
I'm telling you, you could have it too, Leyvon, you know?
Yeah.
So we got to all take care. We got to pay attention to our bodies, you know?
You know, they said because of the BRCA gene that exists in the Bahamas, I actually went to a little breast cancer talk over the weekend a couple of days back. And I listened to women tell their stories about breast cancer and the survival, etc. And I was fascinated, flabbergasted, if you will, when I learned of the amount of women affected by breast cancer. They said 9 out of 10 women have either had breast cancer or had to support a woman that they knew directly with breast cancer in the Bahamas. I mean, that is absurd. That is a 90% rating.
Yes.
And so no matter where you are, no matter how old you are, breast cancer almost sounds to me like if you are a Bahamian living in the Bahamas, breast cancer will visit you at some point.
At some point.
And you know, you said you were 38.
Yeah,
I heard 39. A lady. Mm-hmm. I heard a lady, like I said, at the event I attended, she said she discovered it at 25. I mean, at 25, that is, I can't imagine anything bad happening to 25-year-olds, right? But she said, no, at 25, that was when she discovered it, and that she had to go through it while helping her mommy go through it.
Yes.
And so it was sobering for me, right? Because you don't ever think about it. October comes, you know, we wear our pink shirts every Friday. Mm-hmm. It's more of a fashion statement for many of us.
Yes.
And you don't think about what it symbolizes and how many women are possibly battling this thing.
Yes.
And as I age as an older man, right, you have to begin to think that more and more of the women that you knew all of your life are probably walking around wrestling breast cancer.
Definitely.
You have to be sensitized to this kind of stuff.
Yes.
And even in the instances where her breasts are not affected, that doesn't mean the breasts that are around her ain't affected.
Exactly.
And the mental weight that takes on and puts on people, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm happy that you come today so that we could kind of tell people what to do, what to expect, what to think, how to feel. Well, not how to feel, but how you felt. Anyway.
Yes.
And maybe that can help people that are out there that are kind of afraid to go and have it checked. You said, literally, in the space of 3 weeks, you had gone from stage one to stage three.
That's right.
And by the time as you had gotten to surgery, which was about 3 weeks later, you had to go from doing a lumpectomy to having radiation and chemotherapy to then having to do an entire mastectomy.
Yes.
And that doesn't sound like a period of over a year. That sounds like a very short window.
Yes, yes. Because, like I found out, like around May or so exercising that I felt this lump. Hey, I had to make a decision to go and visit a doctor to do something about this lump. Mm-hmm. And then I go and have the biopsy done a month or so later. Then another month, I had a lumpectomy. Mm-hmm. Then a month later, I go, like 6 weeks later, I go to say, oh, I'm going to start the treatment. Here it is. They find out the cancer's back. So you cannot wait, you know. And I think that's what, because waiting, that's why they say early detection saves lives.
Right.
Imagine now if I had decided, say, okay, that's just a lump. Maybe it's nothing. And I waited, you know. I guess by the time as I really decided to go to the doctor, I might have been at stage four. And you know, there's only four stages of cancer, one, two, and three, and four. And I was almost at the fourth stage.
Right.
So I guess if I had waited, by the time as I really got diagnosed, I would have been at the fourth stage.
Yeah.
And there was no time where there was no window for me to say, play around with my life to wait. I had to take action. So I advise women out there, you feel something wrong, don't just will it away or say, oh, I'm going to pray. Yes, God works miracles. And along my treatment, I did have some miracles because the process, you know, there was this different levels and different times and different stages in my life going through the treatment and all that, that God did perform miracles. Because I remember when I did the radiation, I got burned just only one more week to go. And here it is, I'm way in Baltimore, away from my family, my kids. I'm ready to go home. I've been over there a couple months now, so I want to come back home. And here it is, the doctor's going to tell me that we can't do treatment anymore because you're going to get burned worse. Levi and I was in a point where I had to be topless for 2 weeks because I could have smelled my flesh literally rotting on earth.
Wow.
Yes, because it was just raw and pink. And, you know, one morning I just was.
And this is from radiation.
This is from radiation.
Goodness.
You know, and even though they give you the treatment to put on after every session, I still got burned. And I remember Friday morning getting up and I say, God, if you are real, I say, you have to heal me because I am ready to go home. I prayed that prayer on Friday morning. I'll never forget it. I stayed in my bedroom for 3 weeks without my in-laws seeing me. They bring in, and I didn't even want them to see me because, you know, what I would have to do when taking showers, I couldn't touch that area, just let the water wash the medication because I had to apply medication every day. And once I wanted to clean it up, I would have to go and let the shower just wash away the old medication to put on a fresh set. And this morning, I got up that Saturday morning. I started to tell you, and I looked in the mirror. Every morning I got up, I looked in the mirror, looking, just watching these scars. And when I woke up, the flesh that was oozing and raw, and I could smell it was dry. When I said dry, I keep feeling it because you remember now, I was not allowed to touch it with my hands.
Right.
And I said, God, you are real. You know, here I'm praying this prayer. I want God to answer me.
Right.
But I didn't know he was going to do it overnight.
Oh, yeah?
Overnight, that was a miracle.
Wow.
No story, no, like, that's God. And I was like, when I came downstairs, I didn't go downstairs in 3 weeks. When I ran downstairs, my sister-in-law said, hey, Janine, what's up? I said, girl, I've been healed. I'm healed. And hey, they didn't even believe in God because, you know, they were Muslims, I think they were. And I'm going downstairs bragging, but I just had a miracle yesterday. I said, I'm healed, you know, because now it is. I have the, you know, like when you get a scalding, you see that dry, like hard scalp.
Right.
And I'm trying to imagine, how could this happen overnight? So I know it was God. And she said, hey, what do you want for breakfast? I say, sweet girl, what do you want for breakfast? I'm going to fix you breakfast this morning.
My goodness.
So I'm telling you, along the way, you have your miracles. And, you know, God, we say, some women will just say, well, I'm going to pray to God and he's going to heal me. But God has given man the knowledge, so that they could help us. Sometimes healing is a process.
That was the miracle right there.
And I went through process because I had to do the treatments. And, you know, and I went through hair falling out, the different scarring, because I had so many, the tongue blocking, the face blocking, the face full of acne, and the hands. My hands were like, from my wrist to my all my fingers, it was like I was wearing black glove all the time. My ankles, that's how, these were different side effects from the chemotherapy. You can't be ashamed of those, you know? I mean, this is just something, because sickness is not of God. It is of the devil, you know?
Yeah.
And so we don't put sick. Nobody's going to build themselves to be sick. Who wants to be sick?
Mm-hmm.
And it's no respect of persons. I don't care how much money in the world you have. The poor have it. The middle class and the rich, they all get cancer. It afflicts their body. And guess what? If you got the money to spend on it, you got to spend it. So I always wonder, you know, with the poor folks, you know, what do they do? You know, they got to get support, you know, because it's, the treatments are really expensive, and, you know. And there's some people who don't have insurance. So it's always good if you hear of somebody, a family member or friend, support them. Support the cause. Just like sister, you know, we support. They give out podcasts, and they are a support group helping women.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's always good to be a part of an organization, something like Sister, you know, Breast Cancer Support Group.
I think that's a good place to take a break. Man, listen to me. I almost feel like breaking out in the praise. But only God can do it. Only God can do it. Do it. Don't move. Leyvon Miller is here. I'm here with Janine LaRota. We're talking all things breast today. Listen, let everything that have breast.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. We'll be right back after the break.
October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. Other than skin cancer, breast cancer is the most common cancer in women. Breast cancer is also the second leading cause of cancer death in women, after lung cancer. Can you help? Yes, you can. You can encourage women to take steps to help lower their risk of developing breast cancer and help find it early, when it might be easier to treat. You can also help connect women facing breast cancer to patient programs and services they might need throughout their treatment. We encourage you to share these messages during Breast Cancer Awareness Month and throughout the year. 2021 has been a powerful reminder that we are all in this together, and our choices and actions have the power to protect the most vulnerable among us in a big way. By working together, we can inspire hope and become a force for good and help create greater awareness during Breast Cancer Awareness Month. To participate in our upcoming supplement, contact Guardian Media's advertising department or your account executive today.
Hey, did you find the show interesting? Do you want to be a part of the conversation? Well, sponsor Unleashed today. Call 302-2304 or 302-2375 to see which package is right for you. Join Leyvon Miller as he ignites the passion of the next generation by bridging the gap with engaging conversations and innovative ideas. Take action and sponsor Unleashed today at 302-2304 or 302-2375 and be unleashed.
The new Guardian Radio app is here. Listen live to all our Guardian Radio shows and live video stream select programs in our studio. Get information about Guardian Radio shows and our hosts. Send messages, including text, email, and even call. All from our amazing new Guardian Radio app. Download it free today in your App Store for your Apple device or Play Store for your Android device. The all-new and improved Guardian Radio app.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Welcome back. Thank you for staying with me. Leyvon Miller is here. It's Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. That means I'm unleashed on your radio, which means it's somewhere between 11 and 12 o'clock. Let me just get a quick announcement out of the way. So I hear that Christopher Cawley is having a birthday today, and that they're going to be meeting at Place X. please be advised that as soon as it is reasonably possible, I intend to visit Place X to enjoy the wedding ceremony that will be taking place, and I would like for you all to await my arrival. All right? So just want to let you all know that I intend to be there. Don't have too much of a frolic without me. Also, I happen to have caught a little bit of Aaron Shaw on my way in. And you know something? The part that got my attention was when they said they would use as many letters as they deemed necessary. This is my official petition. I want them to add the letter O for orgisexuals, right? I'll explain that to you a bit later. And if they do that, who knows? Maybe I'll come out and pick it with them, in galvanizing whatever effort it is that they're trying to put together. But Janine LaRoda joins me in studio this morning. And she is a breast cancer survivor. We took you through the journey that she has gone. We took you through her recovery. Now we want to talk to you a little bit about support and education, right? Because a lot of times we assume that people ought to know. Like, if my breast hurts, I ought to know what it feels like. If my breast hurts, I ought to know who to talk to. I ought to know where to go to get tested. And people don't know. I can tell you that. Again, I've had a wonderful opportunity to serve at the board of NHI, and I know for a fact that having a primary physician is a massive benefit on the journey through any medical difficulty. And it is because they're able to monitor your progress, they're able to monitor your deficiencies, they're able to monitor your blood work, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And things that aren't even that you aren't even aware of may show up. If you detect them early enough, you may be able to treat them. And the pathway of care is typically what determines the outcome of the care and your experience with whatever the illness is that you will face in life. You are a human. And if you believe the old Christian song, it says, this old building, it does keep leaning, right? So you said that you find yourself oftentimes, Janine, offering support to people that find themselves going or preparing for the battle of their lives with breast cancer. Mm-hmm. Who are some of the other support groups, some of the other associations, agencies, etc., that you recommend people reach out to? Who are some of the armor bearers that you yourself reach out to? And do you have contacts for any of those people? Let me just give out the phone lines again in case anybody wants to call me. 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. Those are my numbers. You can call me on those. You can text me on 422-4796. I'll get to these text messages. I see them all. Janine, who are the support units that you recommend to people that are about to face breast cancer?
First of all, you have to lean heavily on your faith, mm-hmm. because God is the ultimate healer.
Yeah.
He's the great I Am, the great physician.
Oh, hallelujah.
So once you get to know him and put your trust in him and hold on to him, there's no doubt where you're going. But for most of, your family, that's a family support is great, whether you're married or unmarried. Your mm-hmm. spouse is important to have that mm-hmm. spousal support. I had my family on both sides, my mom, my father, they all supported me through every step and every challenge and every process that I went through. I heard from almost every household in my family. I was fortunate enough mm-hmm. that I had family who really cared, and friends, my colleagues, and even your job. Mm-hmm. It's good to have them support. And your church, my pastor, I'm a member of Evangelistic Temple. I go there where Pastor Juan L. Cash is the pastor, mm-hmm. and his lovely wife, Dr. L. Wendy Cash. Mm-hmm. They supported me. They prayed for me every week in church. They telephoned me, so I had that support rang, and then I joined the sister support group. Mm-hmm. It's women supporting women where they met. They just meet once a month, and we just go and talk about our experience, and it's so good to share, and you learn from other mm-hmm. other women who's going through the same thing as you. Mm-hmm. And so when you get the church there, they're praying for you and your family and your friends, your colleagues, they're supporting you, because even my colleagues at work, they supported me, my supervisor, they know if I when I went through treatments that days after, I still worked during the treatment, mind you, you know, because sometimes they helped me along the way. Because even though I typed and sit in front of a computer and type, I remember I couldn't even use my fingers right. and I had to use the pencil and I hardly could have walked or even stand up to the copier. So my colleagues will help me say, do you need a copy or do you need me to lift you? They didn't even ask. They just did it. Mm-hmm. When time to even go to the bathroom, someone would always walk with me. And I have a one of my good friends. She's like a mother figure, Edith McKinney, you know, who made sure that I was, you know, just doing everything that I was supposed to mm-hmm. do on the job, making sure I get to and from to work because I stopped driving. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you just that moral support and people just, you know, just telling you they love you. I know, like, I'm the oldest child mm-hmm. in my house and, you know, and the only girl that my mom had, I just mm-hmm. lost my mom, by the way.
Wow.
You know, so I'm still in mourning. Mm-hmm. And so I remember, I know that my father, they spoiled me kind of, and they gave me everything I wanted. And they wanted the kind of parents who would say, I love you every day, you know, mm-hmm. stuff like that. And, you know, it took cancer to hear my father say, I love you,
yeah.
you know?
Yeah.
And then, like I said, I don't know if I'm going off course here.
No, go on.
You know, even like my mom, because like going through cancer, you know, like I said, I just said my mom just passed. And here it is, 11 years later, I'm here. She ended up having dementia. Mm-hmm. And so the past 2 years, 3 years of her life, she was with me.
Right.
And I had to take care of her. And I said, if cancer had taken me away.
Yeah. Who would take care of my mommy?
Who would have been here to take care of her,
right.
you know? And so, like I said, and don't be afraid to share. Tell people that what you're going through, mm-hmm. you know, that's not a big secret because people will pray for you. You'll be surprised to know who will pray for you mm-hmm. and who will support you or give you a dollar to help. You know, there were persons who were, oh, I know you're going for another treatment mm-hmm. and they'll push a little token in your hand. Yeah. So you had that moral support and people just showing you love, you know. And I must say I was one of those fortunate persons. I had the support of my spouse, the kids, the neighbors, my church, my colleagues, the sister, brothers, you know, because my mom, I have family in the United States mm-hmm. and Grand Bahama, Abaco, Eleuthera, mm-hmm. and they all took the time to check on me, whether they spoke to me directly or spoke to the kids, but most of the time, they all just wanted to hear my voice to make sure I was okay.
That's great.
It was just that outpouring of love that you made me want to fight, and you got to want to do it on your own, because I don't care how much people support you and people pray. If you don't have that willpower to just want to live, you got to make up your mind that I'm going to beat this thing.
Yeah.
And I told cancer, you ain't taking me out because here it is now. Mm-hmm. I'm a young woman. My husband is still young. I said, I'm going to be his wife. No other woman is going to raise my kids.
Yeah.
So I asked God to allow me to see all of them graduate high school, college, and even walk down the aisle. And today now my last child is in junior high.
Wow.
She's in the ninth grade. And so
I'm still here. And you look like you got at least another 45 to 50
years
left.
I'm telling you.
You got nowhere to go. No time.
So.
It's interesting though. I for those of you that do not know, in another incarnation of my life, I happen to have gotten myself a captain's license, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I also did something called the Nile Inflatable Life-Saving Equipment course. And I also did something called the STCW course, which is the Seafarers Training Certificate Watch course. I think that's what it's called. Anyway, and in there, you have to do survival training. So mm-hmm. I'm trained in survival, right? And they said, here are the three things you need to survive. You need good operational equipment.
Mm-hmm.
You need functioning knowledge of all of your life-saving equipment. Mm-hmm. Chief among them, though, is the will to survive.
Yes.
The will to survive turns out to be the most paramount thing in a life threatening situation.
Yes.
Typically, the difference between the people that make it out of life-threatening situations and mm-hmm. the ones that don't
mm-hmm.
is the will to survive.
Exactly.
And apparently, it sounds to me like breast cancer is no different. If you give up on the will to survive,
mm-hmm.
you lessen your chances of survival by about 50%.
Exactly.
Let me get a couple of these text messages. And this one here says, "Good morning, Leyvon. Please let's use this week to find another parting phrase for the show other than try not to kill anyone or let anyone kill you. It's really crass. I cringe every time I hear it. You can challenge listeners to put forward some suggestions. I don't know. I think with what's going on in our society, that's the best piece of advice I could give you every weekend when I leave here. I don't want you to kill nobody, but I don't want nobody to kill you. I want you to do everything in your power to ensure that you don't kill nobody, but I also want you to double that effort in making sure nobody kills you. This is something I say on Fridays.
Okay.
Yeah, so I guess they must have wanted to say that to me for quite some time. I don't know if I'm going to change it, but I do note with great interest. Yeah, Mr. Cliff Scavalli used to say, I note your position. Yeah? Go to the head of the class and sit quietly if you can. I'm going to try. Hi, so what causes breast cancer? From what I understand, it's something in Bahamians. It's called the BRCA gene. And the BRCA gene kind of makes Bahamian women more susceptible to catching cancer. And what's interesting is because Bahamians typically do not marry outside of our nationality or race, we kind of have created a super gene among Bahamians or among the Bahamian population because we're such a small pool of people that almost makes it unavoidable that you will experience breast cancer at some point in your life. Next text writer here says, great show as usual. Sorry for the late text today. Will this be officially known as Titty Tuesday? I can't say that on the radio. So this is Tata Tuesdays because you can't say the other word because apparently it's offensive. And to that, all I could say is tough titty said the kitty. Jillian, we got 1 minute left. Where do people that, or do you offer support to people that may be going through breast cancer? And do you have contacts that you'd like to let people have?
Yes, I would recommend anybody just reach out to her somewhere. It's a family member, somebody you want to you have find confidence in, mm-hmm. a church, and you know there's the Breast Cancer Society of the Bahamas, which is a good support group. Mm-hmm. They have a group there. You can reach out to them or the Sisters Breast Cancer Support Group, where you can reach them at 326-1929 or 376-0054. You know, Miss Andrea Sweeting, she's doing an excellent job. And, you know, so I just want you to be encouraged, you know. Just hold on, you know. Hold on to God's unchanging hand. Don't let go. Don't give up on him, because he won't give up on you.
Oh, bless the Lord. Thank you so much for coming, Janine LaRota. Anyway, that's my time. I'm smack dab out of time. You know the voice. It's Leyvon Miller. This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Don't move. News, it's now.
Formed against, yes, glory.